Welcome you all to the national webinar organized by Bajaj Model College of Arts and Science, Nettanige, Kasaragod. Title, Multidimensional Impact of COVID-19 Pandemic. Firstly, let me welcome all the speakers. Today, we will be focusing more on the socio-economic and cultural impact of COVID-19. It is the first time in the human history the world is witnessing a complete lockdown. So was India and Kerala. Even during the Spanish flu of 1918, 5 million people were dead. We never went for a complete lockdown. So this makes it really difficult to predict the far-reaching consequences of COVID-19. The economy is facing an unprecedented downturn with both demand and supply shocks. According to IMF, the world is heading to a recession, which is compared to the Great Depression of 1930s, which is far bigger than the subprime crisis of 2009. India is also facing some unique problems. Our huge expatriate population, that's our NRIs, are facing huge risk of losing jobs and returning back to India. Kerala itself gets a remittance of $15 billion. Surely the future is really hard for us. Firstly, let me welcome Mr. Reginus Kottaram, consultant researcher with NLSUA Bangalore. Welcome, Regin. So let me have a couple of questions to you. Do you think the current economic situation of India, and adding to that, what are the major sectors got impacted by the pandemic and what are the stresses?
So today I'll be discussing more on the economic impact of COVID and the subsequent lockdown on Indian economy and how can we come out of this. So when you ask about what's the economic situation, I can say that as of now, economic impact is only a passing thought, because all the state governments with the central government now trying to reduce the mortalities and to reduce the human tragic consequences. And as a secondary that we can surely look to the economic aspect. Economy is very important, that post-COVID, for the last 40 days, our all the economic activities are being stalled. So when we look on the economic aspect, we can say it's a double whammy situation. Like on the one side, it's a demand contraction, and the other side, it's a supply chain disruption. So recently, the chief economic advisor, he has predicted that the GDP growth in the first quarter, that's from April to June, is likely to range between 1 to 2%. And as you also pointed out, one of the major impacts in the economy is the downtrodden growth. And the recently, as IMF has also predicted, there is a dismal growth rate of 1.5%. So when we look at all these issues, we can see the economy is hit from both the sides, from the demand side and the supply side. And when you ask to analyze different sectors, it's impacted. I can say that majority of the sectors got impacted by the pandemic, and no single sector like escaped from the stress. So when we look through the major sectors, we can see that starting from the retail sector, the contribution to retail sector is about 10% to the economy, and about 40 to 16 million people are employed in the sector. When we look at the stress factors, we can see that for the last 40 days, even though retail sector has the capacity to work in an ICT-enabled environment, only 7 to 8% of the retail industry functioned during the lockdown. And it led to a drying up of the cash flows, right? 20 to 25% of the retailers require a capital infusion just to survive. So, and also we know that when we look at the retail industry, even after the COVID, post-COVID, during the post-COVID period, Indians are likely to spend only on essentials in the near future. So it also affects the retail sector in the coming period also. And when we look at the MSME sector, we can say that one of the most important sectors which got hit by the pandemic is the MSME. And it contributes about 29% to the GDP, and it employs about 120 million people. So due to the COVID and the subsequent lockdown, no economic activities are conducted for the MSME sector, and the unpaid bills are piling up. So we all know that many of the our own orders, online orders or other orders are cancelled, or the deliveries are stuck up at many ports. and it led to a fall in the demand or the supply chain got disrupted. So these are the major factors, and also MSME is a sector which is greatly affected by the bad law. And recently the McKinsey and Company conducted a study and they predicted that about 25% of the MSME loans can turn bad. Further, it will lead to a banking crisis.
Okay,
so
another major sector.
So these are the major sectors which got stuck by the pandemic. And if I say quickly, I'll just go through the rescue map for the retail and MSME sector as you asked. I can say that retail sector, just to increase the moratorium to 270 days and increase the credit line for them. And one of the major expenditure for them is a GST. Just so offer a GST waive to the retail sector. And regarding the MSME sector, I think the government should step in for the compensation of wages, at least partially. The government should compensate for the wages, and also a loan repudiation should be given to the MSME sector. Yeah.
Okay, Rishina. It's really shocking to hear the statistics. Also, do you think that a stimulus package from the part of government is required at this point of time?
So I think when we ask about the stimulus package, only the monetary and the fiscal authorities need to be. So they have the only power or the authority to respond at this point of time. And when we think about the fiscal prudence, fiscal stimulus package, we say that it's unlikely or it's not good just to copy or rather just copy a model of fiscal plan as that of a developed country like USA or UK, because we have our own ground reality. Like we have our banking crisis, we have our inflation. So going for just a simple copy of other fiscal deficit or fiscal model, fiscal stimulus model, we can have a unique model. And also when we think about increasing demand or addressing the issue from the demand side, we can say that we need to inject money to the economy. So the RBI should come, the RBI with the other banking sector should have a consensus to do with that. And even recently the RBI governor has told that we are sitting in midst of the liquidity. But the liquidity he is implying is the aggregate liquidity. So I'll always say that liquidity differs from one person to other. So for example, a retail owner's liquidity is different from a mall owner's liquidity. So better to have a proper liquidity index, and then we should use our banking sector. We should provide cheaper working capital loan to the firm, and we should avoid GST traffic. That's the important thing. When we think of the supply side, we should think of to provide a proper GST traffic reduction. Most of the public sector undertakings are still need to pay their last bill. So if they do everything like that, I think it's a better time to increase the productivity of the economy. And we should do that to revive the economy.
Okay, Rijan. So adding to what Rijan said, that today Moody's has predicted India's growth rate will be a zero or a negative one. So India is having a tough time ahead. Thank you, Rijan. So let me invite our next speaker, Mr. Devisankar Sharma, IFS, Indian Forest Service officer under training from Himachal Cadre. So, Mr. Devi, so we are hearing that there are many good news from the part of environment. So, we are seeing the reports that even Himalayan ranges are seen from the Jalandhar. So, how will this lockdown in many countries affect the climate change and the air quality? Is this a boom in disguise in terms of environment?
Yes, as you asked, there is some good news with respect to environment. We can see that the air quality has substantially improved. And if you talk about climate change, what we have been seeing till now is that we have seen global warming because of the improved burning of fossil fuels and increased carbon emissions. Now COVID-19 and the lockdown has now completely reversed the equation. We are burning less fuel. The transportation is completely down. Aviation is down. Similarly, industrial production is down. So there is a carbon crash that is happening. And the has estimated that there will be a reduction of 5% in carbon emissions in 2020. So what is happening right now is a reversal of climate change and global warming. But it must be said that this is only a temporary issue. And once the economic activity restarts, we will be back to places where we burn carbon and the climate change and global warming issues will still remain prominent. So yes, the air quality levels in cities have substantially improved. And as you mentioned, we can see the Dholadhar ranges from Jalandhar. And there are many such beautiful stories. We are also seeing that the flamingos have returned to Navi Mumbai. So yes, I'm able to share my screen now. Please tell me if you can see my screen.
Yes, Ravi, you can. We are seeing it.
Yes. So this is the current state right now. We have empty roads, and this is the global carbon projections for year 2020. You can see that there is a substantial decrease, and this is the Himalayan ranges from Jalandhar. So yes, it is good news, but it is only temporary good news, I believe, because as soon as the lockdown is lifted and economic activity resumes, we'll be going back gradually to the normal. Yes. And yeah, this is the wildlife who have now reclaimed the habitats. Yes.
Okay, Ravi. Okay, I have one more question. Do you think that there is any relationship between the origin and spread of the disease and environmental destructions, as is being discussed?
Yeah. You must have all seen this movie called Contagion. And in the final scene of the movie, there is a scene which shows the origin of the disease. And in that particular scene, there is a deforestation happening, and the bats are being driven out. So this is essentially what is happening in the current situation, where we have a zoonotic disease. And a zoonotic disease is a disease that jumps from animal to human beings, and then the human to human transmission happens. So many of these animals are reservoirs of virus. Any harm to them, like for instance in bats there are many viruses, millions of viruses, and it does not cause harm to them, but as soon as it comes to human beings, it is a deadly virus. And that is exactly what has happened in the coronavirus pandemic situation. So deforestation, habitat fragmentation, and also illegal trade of wildlife, as we saw in the wet markets of Wuhan in China. And it is mostly believed that this species called pangolin was the intermediate host, and the coronavirus from the bat jumped into this intermediate host and then into human beings. So essentially, this is an ecological disaster that we are facing, with human beings being the prime driver of this disease. And we also have studies from Harvard that is published in the New York Times that links air pollution to higher coronavirus death rates. So how this happens is particulate particles aid the transmission of virus, and also the air pollution levels means more pre-existing conditions that make people vulnerable to the disease. So there is definitely a link between ecological destruction and the origin of coronavirus. Yes.
Okay, Ravi. So final question to you. How will COVID-19 impact the government policies with respect to the government across the globe?
Yeah, this is a very pertinent question, and one must, first of all, to predict the government policy is a difficult task, but what we have now is an economic slowdown, and there can be two reactions to this particular crisis. One can be that you realize what is the destruction that has been caused about, and you try to frame an eco-friendly policy. And another and a more probable policy change would be that you try to compensate for the slowdown, you relax environmental regulations, and you offer industry stance to pollute and you degrade the environment. So this is what is happening in many countries across the world. For example, South Africa has decreased the permitted limit, increased the permitted limit for sulfur dioxide and other pollutants. Similarly, the Environmental Protection Agency of United States has considerably relaxed environmental regulations, and the United Nations have called back for this environmental rollbacks, calling them irrational and irresponsible. So this is one kind of government policy where governments give a free hand to industries to degrade environment and to empower their economy at the expense of environment. And another opposite and alternate way could be that governments realize the importance of being taking along the concept of sustainable development. So one such policy that I witnessed was in a city of Bogota in Colombia, where they have introduced biking lanes to reduce the traffic, reduce air pollution, improve air quality, and thus sustain the spread of the virus. So this is the two heads of the coin, the two alternatives of government policy, depending on the political angles of countries and current political dispensation. Yes.
Okay, thank you, Ravi. Thank you, Ravi, for joining with us. So due to shortage of time, let me invite our next speaker, Mr. Augustine Joseph, who is a research scholar from NIT Trichy. He's also doing his PhD in crime economics. So I have a couple of questions for you. The first one. So there are reports showing that there is a decrease in the crime rate in India during this COVID lockdown. What might be the possible reasons for that?
Okay. Mr. Bennett, one of the positive externality regarding this COVID-19, even though it is a pandemic, can have a disastrous effect on global economy and society. But one of the positive externality we can see is that the unexpected fall in crime rates across the world and also in our country. So during this this time, during the time of COVID and the subsequent lockdown state, a fewer number of people are committing crime, especially violent crime like murder, attempt to murder, and property crimes like burglary, theft, crime against women, economic crime. So all such crime has come down significantly. So if you take overall, not only in India, if you take globally, there is a dip in total crime because of this during this COVID time, because of this lockdown. So when it comes to our country, we don't have substantial data available to generalize to entire country, but based on data that we can get or available from other states, few states like Kerala, we can say that there is a considerable dip in total crime and different types of crime during this lockdown period or during the time of COVID. For example, let's take the case of Kerala. So in the first stage of lockdown, the number of murder especially came down. So as compared to last year during this period, we can see a 40% drop in murders committed this year compared to last year. When it comes to violence against women, there is a 100% drop in crime compared to last year. So when we look overall, the total number of crime is coming down, even though people are a little bit frustrated by sitting inside their house. We can see a positive thing about this pandemic or this lockdown is the dip in crime rate totally. And also an interesting fact is that certain relationship that has been proved earlier connecting crime variables and economic variables appear to be contradictory to this particular situation. For example, the existing study shows that there is an indirect relationship between GDP and GDP and crime rate. So, but in this particular scenario, the GDP is coming down. No production is happening. No activities is happening as connected, which may be a contribution to improving GDP. Nothing is happening. So even though GDP is down, we are having a less crime rate, which is an absolute contradiction to what is proved as of now. And the existing study shows that these things are indirect. So whenever is GDP is down, crime rate should go up. So the economic impact is also a little bit affected on this thing, but in a contradictory manner. Yes, Ben.
Okay, Augustine. At the same time, there are also reports shows that there is an increase in the domestic violence and cyber crime, such as child pornography. What's your take on this?
Yeah, correct. Overall, it's correct that overall there is a dip in crime rate throughout the world, but there are certain crimes which is increasing because of maybe because of this lockdown, we can say domestic violence and all. And people may be confused between domestic violence and crime against women. These things are different. When it comes to domestic violence, it most probably happens within a home or a household where the culprits would be relatives and the victims also will be relatives. So such things happens because of sudden aggression or frustration of sitting inside. A kind of a psychological factor is involved there. So people, if you look otherwise, people doesn't have any opportunity to do any particular crime outside, because earlier the ground for crime was most predominantly it was streets. Now because of there is a sudden shift in total social activities, people are confined to their households or house, and suddenly there is a shift from streets to houses as the ground for criminal activities. As I said, it's not economic or any other reason. It's mainly of psychology, and when people are frustrated, they try to relieve it. They may show aggression. So how do they show such aggression? Is that they have people around them, children, women. So men, it's in these cases predominantly the victims are women and children, and the culprits are men. So they just try to relieve their frustration on women and children around them. And it's interesting that these people get violent for silly things. So there may not be any logic behind a particular thing. There might not be a reason to get aggravated, but suddenly out of emotion, a spontaneous reaction, they just relieve their frustration all over the place. And most probably, as I said, the victims would be the relatives around them. And also another thing is, as you mentioned, child pornography, that is also increasing because as we know, everyone is sitting inside. Actually, what leads to pornography is that people doesn't have much things to do. A kind of a feeling of boredom. So if you're feeling bored and if you think that they don't have anything to do, they cannot go out with friends, they cannot go to grounds and play, they cannot go for shopping. So such kind of restrictions are there. So people have a feeling that they don't have much activities to do, and the feeling of boredom somehow emotionally trigger a feeling that without that kind of feeling will be developed inside them, and they may be interested in watching much of these kind of obscene things and I mean browsing in these kind of websites. And as you said, because of that, pornography and related crimes can increase.
So let me invite Mr. Joel Uman, Assistant Professor of Economics from St. Thomas College, Kozhinchery, Pathanamthitta. He's doing his PhD in health economics. So Joel, health sector is one of the most discussed sector in this COVID time. So what is the impact of COVID in the health sector, and what are the changes you expect in the public health sector?
Thank you, Bennett, first of all, for providing this opportunity. COVID situation has brought about an ever important focus on health than ever before. First, all over the nations, health was considered as a public good, and it was given very less consideration. To quote an example, nations having ICBM missiles don't have even proper bottles for IV fluid, like the case of South Korea. So health was often neglected. So the first and foremost point that I would like to share is health cannot be neglected after this COVID scenario. Nations all over the world, time has right enough for them to provide more budgetary allocation in case of health sector. When we're coming to COVID scenario, there were many big points of various economies were brought wide into open. First of all, a concept called the relevance and the significance of family medicine came into the foremost. Unfortunately, when we come into India, at post-graduation level, family medicine or community medicine is less prioritized. It is not a glamour subject, but COVID scenario has brought about the emergency requirement to focus the subject than ever before. Then I would like to focus upon the increasing number of pandemic, especially when we take the care. We have a COVID now. There was a Hendra outbreak in Australia, similar outbreaks in different parts of Tianjin in China. So pandemics are here to stay. So definitely our medical curriculum would now need to give more emphasis on pandemics. Again, another problem is our grassroots level health care needs to be strengthened. You know, the entire doctors, you know, the entire medical workforce is fighting for COVID. But we cannot ignore other diseases too, because people die every day due to many other different diseases. So to cater such an emergency pandemic situation, it's high time for our government to improve the care of the healthcare workers. And post-COVID scenario, we'd always say, yesterday's newspaper said, there might be a population boom after this COVID lockdown. So an entire generation, finally we can say a COVID generation is being into the making. So after the lockdown, the government would have to face more focus and major challenges to health sector than ever before.
Okay, Joel. Also, I have a question for you. Do you think that there is a need for active intervention of government in the health sector, or do we need to strengthen the private players in the health sector in the post-COVID era?
Yeah, definitely. The role of private sector cannot be ignored, especially in Kerala. The 55% of health sector is controlled by private, and their role we cannot ignore them. But the problem, the situation is that the healthcare allocation compared to nations are very less. We are even back of Nepal, Thailand, or to say shockingly, even that of Bhutan. We only spend close to 1.5% of our GDP for health funds. That is very shocking. And our government's utmost target by 2025 is to spend allocation around 2.5%. So such an allocation of funds is so meager. And also in this battle against diseases, both private sector and public sector, they should go in hand. One cannot replace or substitute for the other. And also to quote another statistic, when we compare to G5 or G10 or G20 nations, we have a poor bed ratio. To quote an example, we have an 8 physicians or 8.5 beds per 10,000 people, while a country like Japan or South Korea have 100 beds per 10,000 people. So it shows a dismal parity of healthcare infrastructure. So to increase such bleak points and to cater to them, indispensable. And also we have certain diseases. For example, the top 4 cases for mortality in India are cardiovascular diseases, pulmonary artery diseases, diabetes, chronic hypertension. And also an important bleak point in Indian healthcare sector is we have a high number of mortality rates due to road accidents. So emergency trauma care and critical care are also the which is the need of the hour. Statistically speaking, you have an accident in the US or in India. A man who is feeling the accident in the US have the more chance for survival. So it also shows the urgent requisite that our critical care or the trauma care have to be improved as well. So again, we have tertiary super specialty institutions. We bask on the increasing the number of AIMS. But rather than burdening the tertiary institutions with all sort of cases, if we classify or strengthen from the grassroots level, focusing and allocating the healthcare cases to primary, secondary, and tertiary level, the burdening of large institutes can be reduced. So to quote a single example, a problem in Kerala is that every cancer patient is in a situation to go to RCC in Trivandrum. But instead of that, I think at least in 4 or 5 areas, institutions part to RCC can be made down. Ordinarily, we have institutions like MCC or other medical colleges, but they are not up to or as that of an institute like RCC or Cerebrum. So definitely, the role of government or the public sector is not going to change. It keeps on increasing and increasing, especially after the COVID scenario.
Okay, thank you, Joel, for sharing your views with us. So we have a couple of questions from our audience. So the first question is to Mr. Rijinas Kottaram. So what is the extent of COVID in the Kerala economy? What is the extent of impact of COVID in the Kerala economy? Susan, can you hear me?
Okay. Okay. Yeah, I can hear you. Okay, Bernard. So when, first of all, I see it in a way so that it's a really humanitarian crisis rather than an like economic point of view or an economic crisis. So when we look on different economies, most of the state economies are affected. And if we look at the Kerala economy in specific, we can see that recently the Kerala State Planning Board has prepared a report and given that about 80,000 rupees crore losses have happened between the April to June. Like they are predicting it's going to happen between April and June. And we also know that Kerala economy is highly dependent on the service sector, about 62%. Is the dependency. So the service sector is affected and the tourism sector mainly is affected. About 20,000 rupees crore is there, loss is there. And also the agriculture sector, we know that many of the agricultural areas, there is no migrant laborers. They already left the places. And it's led to a loss of wages also. About 200 crore wages loss is happening in the Kerala economy as well. And if we look at the different sectors, we can see a dip in the economic status. But the good thing with Kerala is that Kerala has a higher like expenditure investment in the health sector. So according, like when we compare with different other states or with any other countries, Kerala is fast recovering. So the hope is that if we have the time to like restart our economic activities, we can revive the economy. So increasing in health expenditure is a good, and we have the experience of recovering Nipah. We had 2 floods. So in with respect to Kerala economy, I think the fast recovery makes it more hopeful to get back the economy in track.
Okay, Rijinder, do you have any suggestion for that reviving our economy?
Like I think mostly we should concentrate mainly on the service sector. Because the service sector is mostly affected even after the post-COVID period. We should concentrate more on the service sector by giving some of the, I already pointed out that giving a GST waive is a good thing and providing working capital loans. to most of the firms. Like if we provide a working capital firms to the capital loans to the firms which are not firing their employees, it will help injecting the money. And also the government, let's say we can see if you have a proper policy to accommodate the people who are coming from the abroad and the NRIs, if we have a proper policy to accommodate them, we can like strive the economy and we can move forward.
Okay, Rijan. So there's one more question from our audience to Mr. Joel. Joel, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay, Joel, the question is, what is your opinion about the current allocation of health expenditure to GDP in India? Do you think that the government must spend more amount on health sector?
Yes, definitely. It's high time for government to spend. And the target of India government is to spend in a percentage of around 2.5% around by 2025. Now it's astonishingly low. We have all nations like Japan, USA, UK, all the nations we compare with India having double digit figures of their healthcare fund allocation. So it's high time for the government for increasing funds. I think the government is also on the right track. The Ayushman Bharat scheme and Nottingsley to many other schemes, there are increasing number of health schemes and they are showing this positive trend of increasing our allocation. But I wish the government would speed up this and I hope that we sooner or faster we catch up with those rates of our peer where we have expenditure allocation. So definitely it's high time for government. And also India is rightly called as a pharmacy of the world. Many third world countries, especially from South America, Africa, they depend for generic medicines for India. So the increasing allocation for this sector is not also affecting Indians alone. So it's also affecting a lot of poor lives, men, especially in the third world. So at least for not only for Indians, but for the many of the poor, the underprivileged of the third world, it's high time for India government for increasing the GDP allocation in healthcare.
Okay, Joyla, thank you. So hope you can conclude. Due to the shortage of time, we are winding up the webinar. So we have received diverse opinion on the impact of COVID. So we would see that the economy is largely affected and most of the countries are experiencing a massive job loss and negative growth rate. So there are also some good news that our air quality has improved and there has been a decrease in the crime rate. We also understood the strength and weakness of our healthcare system. I'm sure that we will overcome the situation. Hope the government will take the necessary steps to overcome this situation. Once again, I would like to thank all the speakers and the audience. Thank you. Have a good day.